Do and you then... want your plane running a 6x kernel? Because I don't. Hey, everyone. Welcome back to Linux Weekly, Daily Wednesdays, where we sit back, relax, take that midweek break. Talk about some of the fun things. You know what I meant. Going on in the world of Linux and open source. I've been Stone, joined every week by Jill Bryant. Everybody watching us live. If you get a chance, come pop in, say hi. We're always doing this on Wednesdays, except for next week, because Jill's leaving.
No.
Jill's not leaving. She's going to be at her house, but I'm going to be taking an opportunity.
I got to entertain family coming into town, so.
I'm going to be taking an opportunity to do something that I've had just like sitting in the side. You might, if you remember from long, long ago, actually, a couple of months ago, I ran across that Gen 1 Apple TV.
Oh, that would be perfect then. Yeah.
And that's why it's been sitting around. I'm like, all right, now we're going to take an opportunity. We're going to be doing a live stream. We're going to put Linux on it.
Cool,
then.
We're going
to peel it apart. We're going to upgrade the spinny drive. We're going to put an NVMe. Well, we're going to put an SSD in it. I'm going to show you how to do a converter because you got to convert the pins out. And it'll be a fun little video. And we'll see what we can do with a 32-bit only x86 single core Celery with a, I think, 200 megabytes of RAM.
Yeah, and you found the remote, so you have to have the remote to install Debian on that thing.
Two remotes.
Good.
I found the remote after I ordered a remote.
Yes. Oh, that's right.
Right? I have two Apple TV remotes. They're nice. They're aluminum, and we're gonna use them, hopefully. But I've been playing around with a new plugin. If you follow me on Blue Sky or Mastodon, I might have posted it on X or Zitter or whatever for live audio production. And it's something I think is going to be able to get shoehorned into podcast production. That's what I'm testing out right now. Live in production is a tool from the Linux Studio project for, he's worked on an auto gain algorithm.
Oh, nice.
Live, and I'm seeing what it can and cannot get away with, because what it's not is you have no level control, you have no compression set up, you're just blaring and bleeding into a microphone, and you try to throw this on and it's not going to help you out. But if you can get things tamed, what it's going to do is work more like a mastering at the end of your mastering chain before you'd go out live or before you would want to record your podcast, because there's just some atrocious podcasts out there. I want to make an offer, because I'll make this offer here, because when I make it on Saturday, it's going to get insta-filled. So you got until you hear this until probably Saturday night is, I need audio samples that I don't need. I would like some audio samples from a podcast that's not a podcast that I do, because that is cheating. Because I've been doing it for so long. I know everybody's ticks. I know everybody's EQ, everything. So I don't care if you're doing a two-person podcast and you've done five episodes. If you want to take a crack, I'll mix one for you for free. I'm not going to edit it for you, but if you're willing, like, hey man, I got a multi-track, me and my friend, we do a show, I don't care if it's about cars, it would be hilarious if you don't mind that audio or a snippet of that audio being used in a how to do a Linux podcast under Linux with Linux, because Linux, I'm going to see how many times I can work a Linux into the title of the video and the actual guide. And using this particular plugin. So get in touch with me. You got to figure that out. You know, at reply me, whatever. Send it an email. And if you don't have a problem with that being used for that, yeah, we'll run your podcast through the Linux Teamcast machine. How about you, Jill Bryant?
Awesome.
What do you got going on? What's new?
Oh, just lots of holiday festivities and happy Thanksgiving and happy Turkey Bird Day tomorrow to everyone here in the U.S. And there won't be an LWW next week, but we'll be returning in 2 weeks. So next week you can watch Ven put Linux on his Apple TV, first gen. That'll be cool.
First thing we got coming up this week is GNOME.
Yeah.
Has received a donation from Deutschland.
Yeah, so this is really big news for one of the most used open source projects in Linux. In fact, it's the default desktop on many Linux distros, is GNOME. And GNOME received a 1 million EU investment from the Sovereign Tech Fund. And the Sovereign Tech Fund is actually a German government-funded initiative run by Adriana Groh and Fiona Krakenberg. And actually, because I didn't know what the Sovereign Tech Fund was, I did some research on it. And on their website, they state, the Sovereign Tech Fund supports the development, improvement, and maintenance of open digital infrastructure. So very, very cool. And what GNOME plans to do with the funds is very exciting. They want to improve tooling, accessibility, and support features that us users need and want. And I was very excited to hear that GNOME plans to use the money to improve the current state of accessibility, quote, and, quote, design and prototype a new accessibility stack, as this is just so needed on the Linux desktop. And, you know, the GNOME desktop is currently really the best at accessibility with the inclusion of the Orca screen reader and other great tools which are integrated. But it could always be better. We need better tools for accessibility on Linux, absolutely. And for the GNOME Foundation, I actually have a suggestion of an open source app that is greatly needed on Linux for those who have a hard time typing or are dealing with carpal tunnel. A good speech-to-text app that is integrated in the desktop. That is, I hear from so many people that they want that functionality on Linux, and there's very limited options out there. So having it in the GNOME desktop, along with the Orca screen reader and you know, Zoom magnifying programs would be really great. And because I use them myself. And, you know, I actually have been for years donating to the GNOME Foundation. And when we're at scale, I bought some merch from them to support them. Like this t-shirt I'm wearing. It's my GNOME shirt. Love GNOME. So they're it's just a really good desktop that's improving. With every release, there's huge improvements.
Hey, GNOME. Hi. How you doing? Oh, man, Ben. Maybe. One place you could spend that money is, let's head over to the foundation.gnome.org.
Oh, website. Yeah. Error 503, no healthy backends. Uh-oh.
Foundation.gnome.org. I'm just picking because nobody wants to ever deal with that. But yeah, we were getting ready for the show and we were checking out the web zone. It's like, poof, it's been gone all morning. So hopefully everybody gets it back up. It's great to hear. I know a lot of people were asking. I've seen this has been posted. This is not breaking news. We just wanted to cover it. It's people have asked, you know, this is Germany donated. You know, this is where the fund is coming from. Like, well, what about KDE? You know, the desktop.
Yes.
From I don't think they applied for it. So this wasn't a snub.
Oh, yeah.
Calm down and face it. You should be running XFCE anyway, right? So don't worry about it. All right.
Or Window Maker.
Good.
Window Maker could use $1 million.
They just, I don't know if you could trust the Window Maker people for $1 million, Jill.
Aww.
No, that's good because, you know, GNOME is kind of like the default bit.
Yeah.
You know, when you think about it, get your rollouts like Red Hat, government installations, places like that. And that's where you're going to see GNOME. Cool. I don't have a problem with it. Like, I can't. Mm-hmm. I don't participate in the desktop manager wars anymore, man. That was 20 years ago.
Let yeah.
Krita, speaking of KDE.
Yeah.
It's a great little, can't even call it little anymore. Krita's kind of grown beyond.
Yeah, it's little, huge.
Hasn't it?
Yeah.
How long has Krita been around?
Oh, gosh. 2000. I remember seeing a talk at scale about Krita, and that was when it was fairly new. So within the last 20 years.
I had to go look that up. 2005.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, okay. It's been around. What is Krita? All right, it's like GIMP. I mean, open source Rust, but it's raster graphics, 2D art, animation. And why are we talking about it? Well, generative AI. That's pretty neat. I think that's pretty neat. From within Krita, I know it's coming from inside the house. Now, this is a plugin. Let me be very clear about that, because I kind of fell over. I was really surprised to see somebody working on this, since like the Krita community, like the core dev team have been very anti-AI, and you know, each to their own. I'm not judging on that. But this is aiming to provide what the fill and expand bits do, currently do, because you know, you want to keep up with the Photoshops, and that's what Photoshop already has, man. You know, this is going to supply in-paint, out-paint, live painting, and upscaling. It's all going to be there, and it's going to work with CUDA on the back end for NVIDIA or Rackham for our AMD brothers and sisters, and it's using Comfy UI as its back end. And of course, it's got different plugins for, I think, does it have the, GPU cloud?
Yeah, so that was cool.
Rent a GPU. Yeah. And I just wanted to give this a mention, because little things like this, I just find it neat. I don't know. What do you think about this stuff?
Oh boy. So I'm on the same, I feel the same way that you do, Ven. I really don't, you know, it's not an alternative to actually doing it yourself. It's supposed to enhance what you're already doing and what you're already creating. And I know there's so many artists out there who are scared to lose their jobs. I know animators who are really scared right now, because there's such really good, you know, AI generated animation out there. And the same holds true with graphic artists. And, you know, that this is scary, but I really think that Krita, this plugin, handles it really, really well. I mean, I thought it was cool. There's a couple features in it that I thought was really awesome. You can actually generate new images by using words or existing images in the prompts. Now, again, is it really your artwork if you have a computer generate it? You know, this, like me and Ven were saying, it's better to create your own and then you know, accentuate what you've already made by maybe making a higher resolution or, you know, fixing areas that need help, that kind of thing. But it is nice that it has that feature for people that aren't artists. So I gotta say that. It's such a gray area in life right now, Ven.
Machines can't make art, Joe.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why I have been, since the creation of the camera, against it.
Yeah.
Because a camera shouldn't be allowed. It's a machine that creates art.
It's a camera. No. The other cool thing about this that I was happy about is it actually has a really nice history function. So whenever you do it, you know, you do any change, there's a preview. You can go back and switch to that preview, because there is a nice history, which is really great. So if you make a lot of changes to your image, which those of us who are artists have and do all the time, it's nice to be able to go back to one that you maybe like a little better than the current one you're using. So that's in there. They thought about that. They thought about having, you know, history, which is good, because Krita is excellent when it comes to being able to, you know, have a non-destructive interface. So I'm glad they had history there.
I'm next. It's something that shouldn't come to much of a surprise to anybody out there. You might have noticed earlier this week, there were several reviews posted on the YouTubes and on the internet about the new Threadripper from AMD. A doomed product, unfortunately, I say. With a Threadripper. Multiple reasons. Expense being kind of the cherry on top. The this is completely priced out of like the original Threadripper, like Threadripper have right now. It was expensive.
Yeah.
It wasn't cheap, but it was affordable expensive. It was the all right, I can save up and buy that. Then we got then they just went completely crazy with the Threadripper Pros. They're like, oh, okay, that's going to be $3,000 for a CPU. I'm like, no, it's not, because I'm not buying that. But all the benchmarks that we've seen so far, Jill, have been on a particular operating system, haven't they?
Yeah, they sure have. There is a new AMD Ryzen Threadripper Pro 7995WX processor with, yes, it has a whopping 96 cores available. That's just insanity. And as Ven was saying, what operating system do you think runs faster on the 96 core? Threadbooper, as I like it, that Ven calls his Threadripper a Threadbooper. It's cute. Well, what operating system do you think runs faster on the Threadbooper? Well, Linux, of course. So there have been hardware benchmarks recently that show, you know, Ubuntu running 20% faster on the new 96-core Threadripper Pro than Windows 11. And honestly, this is no surprise to me or a lot of you out there, as Linux is optimized for high core counts, you know, server-side, enterprise, and it's just more efficient on these systems. But in the article, the test system was actually an HP Z6 G5 workstation featuring the Ryzen Threadripper Pro 7995WX, 128 gigabytes of DDR5 memory, a Samsung NVMe SSD, and a GeForce RTX A4000 GPU. And the Windows used was Windows 11 Pro version 23H2, which was benchmarked versus the latest Ubuntu, which is Ubuntu 23.10. And some of the apps they used were LuxCore, Intel Ombre, OSP Ray, Geekbench, Blender, video coding, and more apps were used for the tests. But overall, Ubuntu performed 19.5% faster than Windows 11, with the exception, you know, of a few benchmarks that Windows 11 did beat Linux on. But this is pretty amazing. I mean, this is, as Ven knows, who has a Threadripper, knows the performance of Linux on their Threadripper is bar none. Windows really hasn't caught up to it, which is cool.
When the initial Threadripper, it wasn't even the first first-gen Threadrippers weren't too bad because you had 8, 12, and 16 core.
The smaller cores, and Windows was okay.
Windows wasn't too bad with it. And of course, we're talking about like Windows 10 era, like right when that was coming out. Now, when Gen 2 Threadripper came out, we didn't have an 8 core, but we had a 12 core, 16 core. Then we had the 32 core.
Yes.
The WRX7? I forget the name of it. I'd have to look that up. But that one, Windows didn't know what to do with. It was tragically bad. But Windows has gotten better. You know, just the fact that it understands that, like, hey, there's 96 cores available. I can kind of do some stuff. But no, I mean, I was curious when I saw all the benchmarks. You know, I kind of want to. I feel like selling my soul, though.
You want to test it with Windows versus Linux yourself.
You got to buy into the system. You got to start playing the game with the vendors and AMD and NVIDIA and everybody else and be like, hey, can I do the review sample game? And I know how this is played. I talk to these people. I'm in a private Discord with these tech tubers. I'm like, I understand. I see what goes on behind the scenes. Getting all this stuff done, then having to go, okay, now they will go watch the video, and then they got to get feedback on the video, change some stuff, and all. Like, I don't want to do that, but there is a need for somebody to take the stuff and do. You know, fortunately, we have at least level one tech, so we do get some video benchmarks.
But
everybody else was like, here's how a 96 core Threadripper runs on Windows 11. Like, why? Why'd you just waste everybody's time with that? Poorly. I could have told you that.
But it's good to have articles out there like this so that people in the wild see, oh, maybe I should put Linux on a Threadripper, booper, not Windows.
I think it's kind of strange, though. AMD's not even bothering to market the Threadripper because, you know, we still have like the Threadripper Pro, but in this regular Threadripper, and they're both like pretty criminally expensive for what they are.
Yeah.
But they're not trying to market the HEDT platform towards peasants like us. Like myself and you at home listening. But again, that first generation and the second generation Threadripper was, I should have went and got my motherboard. Like, no joke. The MSI Creator motherboard, $500, it has gamers all over. It's got RGB on the motherboard, people.
Yeah.
Like, they were like, come play the games.
Yeah, it was aimed at the consumer workstation as opposed to
get all these cores and you can play all the games and it's going to be great. And I was like, man, that's a really cheap EPYC motherboard at the time. Let me get that and buy this Threadripper because it's a really cheap EPYC CPU. Now it's cheaper to buy EPYC CPUs and EPYC motherboards. That's where we're at. What do we have next? Linux and Itanium.
Yeah, another processor. Yay.
I want to call just talk about this real quick before we get out of here. Will anybody save Linux on the Itanium? Absolutely not. That comes from the register. Like everything else is going to be in our show notes. It's doomed. And we talked about this a couple of months ago that they're going to take out Itanium support out of the Linux kernel. And, you know, it's been announced. Itanium is going to go away in kernel 6.7. And as a tradition, the people come out of the woodwork. They protest the change. This will happen with everything. But surprisingly, Linus is kind of open to the idea.
Yeah.
You know what?
It's cool.
maybe. I am not completely against it. But what he said was, I'll tell you what. You know what? You want me to get Itanium support back in the kernel? How about you maintain an out-of-branch patch set for the architecture for a year? Then come back to me, get everything updated, get it modernized, and we'll bring it back into the kernel. Huge fan of the strategy. Go do the work, then come back, and I'll make sure it works out for you. Works 100% of the time, and it stops all the people that are just OMG change panic, you know? They're like, oh, they're getting rid of floppy drive support from the Linux kernel.
Yes. Like,
cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, same here, Ven. The strategy seems, you know, on point to me, too. And another point that Linus had that I wanted to tell everyone about is that he states, the thing is, nobody doing new kernel codes wants to deal with Itanium. So relegating it to the same situation that i386 support was, it still works in old kernels, doesn't seem to be a huge issue for the people who actually want to use those machines. And as someone who still owns and uses i386 machines, I understand why, you know, it was deprecated from the Linux kernel. I just run older Linux kernels on those machines, like Linus says. So, you know, holding true with the Itanium, I think that's a good strategy. And if there is support for it and developers want to step up and continue the support, then Linus says, go ahead. Have a field day. It's great.
Do the work, and it's great. We don't have a problem. We can hang out. We can be friends. I love that response because that is going to completely put the kibosh on the people going, it'd be great if you brought it back, but I don't want to do the work. I'm like, well, if you want to do the work, it can come back. I'm like, well, I guess it has to go away, doesn't it? I'm like, yeah, I guess it does. There 100% there's installations out there. There are Itaniums in the wild. Not as widespread as you might think and not in places where you might expect, but hey, there's your incentive to get that budget approved for next year, man. But here's the other thing. You're not running the latest and greatest. You're running, I wouldn't be surprised. You're talking like 3X, 4X kernels.
Yeah. And the same like goes with Inertia was saying in chat, a lot of planes still use floppies, and yeah, they do. The floppy driver is still in the kernel. It's just not being, you know, wasn't being maintained in newer kernels is all. And most of the planes use older software anyways.
Want your plane running a 6X kernel? Because I don't.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah. I want it to be hardened for for aerospace and have lots of testing done. So I'd prefer it if it's an older kernel.
That is strange. You know, if you need it, and this is, you know, I'll butt heads with the vintage retro computing crowd. Mm-hmm. And they're like, but I want to run, you know, the latest and greatest on my 20, 30-year-old PC. And I'm like, get stuffed. I mean, go run something period correct on it, right?
Yeah.
All right, beautiful people. Before we get out of here, if you like what we do, head over to linuxgamecast.com. You want to support the show? We got a bunch of ways to do it. We got Patreon. We got LibraPay. We got PayPal. We got Bitcoin if you're into that hacker crypto stuff. We also have Amazon wish list. Jordan has one. Jill has one. Pedro has one. You know, you can pick us up something from Amazon. Send in a note. We might even read it on the air. I got one for the studio. That'll get you on that Blinkatron board back behind me that people look at. We got a merch store, Amazon storefront, and of course, our humble affiliate.
The
best thing you do, show up, watch us live, drop some comments, share the show. We appreciate it. But that's going to wrap us up for this week. I'll be back next week telling you all about what is the latest and greatest in eye technology with the original Apple TV. It'll be a fun time. Time for some credits.
Yeah, time to thank all our wonderful patrons and viewers. Oh, and I see you in YouTube, Low Spec Linux Laptop and Whiskey. Thank you for joining us. And we've got Kanigan, we've got Inertia in, we've got Mirror PPC in, we got Artharin in. Oh, and Scott Machode. So many cool people watching us live and contributing to LWW. Thank you so much. All our lovely patrons. There's so many, they fly by on the credits so quickly that I can't read them all. Love you all.
Have a great rest of your week, everybody. Bye-bye.